First thing I want to talk about language is that it's universal. There are no cultures that do not have language. I know that should be self-evident, but it's sometimes we have to state it in order to make it clear. It is also language that transmits your culture. Some of it you observe, but the meaning behind it is explained through language. And language is often very, very nuanced. This sometimes makes it difficult to do translations because you may not have the same word in another language. For example, Persian, which is a very small language to start with, they use Arabic and English and Russian and French words because those are all the people that have been involved with colonizing that area at one time or another. But they don't have a word for hickey. They don't know what it is. The thought of biting somebody until they got a bruise creeps them out. I know, because I've asked them, as I was learning Persian, I was like, well, you know, because you always want to learn the swear words and the weird words first, right? And so we were going through a list of things, and hickey showed up on one of the lists. I won't go through the rest of it. And then my friend was like, the fuck are you talking about? There's no such thing. And so I described it. He goes, why would anybody do that? I said, well, I don't know. I agree with you on that respect, but I was just wondering what the word was. He says, no, we can't do it because you don't have the concept. If a word doesn't exist, does the thing that it represents exist? Probably not, right? And so it is through our language that we pass knowledge generation to generation, right? You may have the smartest dog in California. Your dog can do tricks up one side and down the other, and her puppy might pick up a few of them through repetition and practice. But not because mama sat down and said, okay, Junior, here's how you lie, you roll over and play dead. Your master will love this, right? Roll over and play dead, right? Because they don't have the language with which to do it. They can copy it, mimic it. But they can't transmit the meaning behind the roll over and play dead. I don't know what the meaning is, but maybe in dog's language it'll be there. I don't know. And so one of the things that differentiates us from all other creatures on this planet is that we're able, through language, to transmit what we learned to the next generation, which can then be transferred to the next generation. I know we spend a lot of time in school in our society, but you know what? Most of what you're going to pass on to the next generation is stuff you learned from your mom and your dad. The things that are important, how you view the world, what you think is important, your preferences, your diet, the literature you think is important, the movies you think are important, the songs you think are important. Right now you're in an age where you're rebellious, so you don't like mom's music, but you know what? 10 years from now, when mom's dead and you hear her favorite song, you'll remember it, right? It's part of what happens. So language is a process that is part of what we refer to as enculturation, the process of acquiring your culture. Like I said, you do this in a lot of different ways. So this is how each of us as individuals learns our culture. We learn our language at the same time we learn culture. We learn the meanings of words, the meanings behind words, behind phrases, at the same time that we're learning the words. So we're not only learning the words, but we're learning their cultural context, where that word is placed and how it plays an important role in our lives in the future.
Language sets us apart. Other animals communicate, but they don't have anything approaching the sophisticated grammar of human languages. How is it that we learn to speak and think in language so easily? Young children become adept in a new language very quickly. Since the dawn of philosophy, thinkers have argued about whether or not we have innate ideas, whether we are born knowing things, as Plato believed, or rather, as John Locke and other empiricists argued, the mind is a blank slate on which experience writes. An American linguist, Noam Chomsky, gave a twist to this debate in the 1960s by demonstrating that children learning to speak just don't have enough information to form the complex grammatical maneuvers that allow them to generate unlimited new and original sentences. Yet they do so with ease. There's a poverty of stimulus. Something else must be going on. Chomsky's hypothesis was that there are inborn structures in our brain, what he called a language acquisition device, or LAD, which gives us a natural propensity to organize the spoken language that we hear in various grammatical ways. Without that, we couldn't get started as language learners. If he's right, language structure is hardwired as a kind of universal grammar. Our slates have been written on before we emerge from the womb.
Now, for most languages, the relationship between the word and the object is arbitrary. Why is a cat called a cat? Exactly, right? Just somebody went around making sounds one day, it's, that's a cat. Okay, that's a cat, right? It has nothing to do with the sound it makes or anything it does, right? But there are words that the word, and this is true in any language, although the onomatopoeia may be different in different languages, that the sound and the word are the same thing. That's an onomatopoeia. If I don't think about it, I can say it. If I think about it, I screw it up, right? So some of those would be words like boom and pow and whap, right? All of the fighting in your comic book, right? Slap. Right? That's the sound that a slap makes, right? Ask a Persian what a rooster says, and they'll go, go-ka-doo-doo. It's almost the same, right? Might be a little different, right? But they're very, very similar. And often things that are an onomatopoeia in one language are an onomatopoeia in another language. Not always, but sometimes, because it's the sounds that lend itself to that. Also, a number of these are Norse words, by the way. Now, language starts off big with the whole language, and then it breaks it down into smaller and smaller pieces. So we're going to start at the very, very basics to try to understand how language works. And the first of those is to understand the simplest form of language, the simplest combination of sounds that one can make. And so a single syllable, but usually, that has meaning. Phonemes. Right? These are the basic building blocks. By themselves, they have no meaning. For example, the P in pin, or the SP in spin, right? By themselves, they don't have any sound. Now, if I ask you, what sound does P make? You'd go, puh. That's two sounds. The p. And then you stick a vowel on to try to make it, right? So when I ask you, what sound does this letter make? It's What does SP make? Sp, right? There's no uh at the end of it. That's a third, that's an additional sound. So breaking it down, and what I'm trying to explain is that we're breaking it down to the very, very smallest pieces. Just sounds. Some languages use letters or combinations of letters to represent these. Some languages use characters to represent these. And it's how we put it together. A phonology is a description of all of the elements of a language's phonemic system. So you want to learn a language, you pull out, first lesson when you take Intro to Spanish 1 as a freshman in high school, you start out A, B, C, D, right? You start off with the alphabet and the sounds that they make. And it's easier in Spanish because they're probably pretty close to only one sound per. Not necessarily, but much better than English, which is a bastard language. And it's a language that's a bastard as well. Morphemes are the smallest unit of a language that does carry meaning. Right? Anthropology is combined of two morphemes. Human, mankind, and the study of anthropology. So, they may be entire words, would be a morpheme. Banana is a morpheme, right? We know what a banana is. or an apple or a papaya. I don't know why those are all fruit. That's just what I put down there. So a simple word may be a morpheme. But as I said with anthropology, you can combine morphemes into more complex words. How many of you took Greek or Latin in high school? Nick and I are the only two that did. Okay. He had Latin. I had a semester of Latin, a semester of Greek. The only reason I took Latin and Greek in high school was to learn the morphemes. If you know the morphemes in Latin and Greek, and you come along across a big scientific word, you don't know what it is, you break it down into the morphemes, right? Because that's how those words were built. And so many words are made up of morphemes. But then you can use additional morphemes to modify the word, right? So many words have past tense, present tense, right? Any verb has all these different tenses of when it happened. Well, sometimes those changes are a morpheme that's attached to it. Likewise, you want to negate something, right? When was the last time you said something was tenable? But I bet you more recently said something was untenable, right? You put that un, that suffix or a prefix, a suffix at the end, a prefix at the beginning. In fact, tenable has a suffix already, because the base word is ten, but not the not the number, right? Tenable, untenable, right? A morphology, then, is an explanation of the various elements that we call morphemes. So a list of morphemes is what I took in high school. Nick had actual real Latin. He had to learn the grammar and all that shit. All I had to learn was just the pieces. I don't know which one of us got off the better end of the deal. He's got a better memory than I do, so I think he did. Now, a syntax is how we define, how we put phrases and sentences together. And in English, and in many languages, but not all, we have several elements, nouns and verbs, adjectives, adverbs, other modifiers, with which we construct our sentences. The use of singular and plural is part of every language. What, you know, I crack up, it never fails. I read your stuff online. According to you guys, there's only one anthropologist. Because in the past, anthropologist did. Put an S on the damn thing, right? It needs an S if you're talking about more than one. And yet, 80% of you in your posts and your papers write an the anthropologist in the past. Put an S on it, right? Come on, think about what you write. Gender may be part of this, right? Many languages are very, very gendered. For example, how would you say computer in Spanish? What's the prefix you'd put on it? No. It's a lie. It's an el computadora. It's one of the few exceptions. It is an el computadora. In other words, it's a female with a male pronoun, right? So gender can be very important. In Persian, the only gender that matters is the subject. So this is an article. So if you say, for example, I'm going to talk about his sister, then everyone in the sentence is female. Regardless, every word in the sentence that I use has the female gender, regardless of the fact that they may or may not be male, because the sentence is female, right? And so he'll say, his brother, she did this, because the rest of the sentence is either female or male. So different languages have different syntaxes. This is the hardest part to learn in most languages. Beauty of Persian is you put the noun at the beginning and then everything else can go in any order after that. I mean, literally, any order. You just kind of piece it together and go, okay. A lexicon is a list of words that define a language. We have what is the official source of English words, or the official repository of English words? Yeah, the OED, the Oxford English Dictionary, the big one, the one at Oxford, That's where all the actual legal words sit. You might buy an Oxford Dictionary, but it's not the Oxford Dictionary because it's not copywritten. You can have anything you want. But those aren't lexicons. Lexicons are just lists of words. And the earliest dictionaries were simply that. They were lexicons. They were just lists of English words. It was to help standardize spelling. Why would standardized spelling become important? For clarity, because of what? No. The printing press. Once the printing press with removable type becomes readily available, people start to learn to read. In fact, reading was taught separately from writing. 15th, 16th, 17th century, you were taught to read or write. A few people were taught to do both. But many people who wrote, really, if you wrote, you could kind of read. But many people could read but couldn't actually form the letters or form the sentences. So they were taught separately. So a lexicon is just a list of words. A dictionary has definitions. First English dictionary, what was the definition of the word sock? Right, S-O-C-K. Something worn between the foot and shoe. That's the original official definition of a sock. Something worn between a foot and shoe. Works. Yeah, it's something. So the lexicon is a list of words. A grammar is all of the rules. Remember I said syntax was part of the rules? Well, grammar is all of it, is the phonology, the morphology, the syntax, and the lexicon all pulled in together. Now, words are always approximation, right? My expectation when I use words is that you know what, yes, sir? I hate it when that happens. Isn't that the Tuesday, Thursday class?
It says Monday, Tuesday.
Hang on a second. There we go. Tuesday, Thursday. Yeah, if you can't find yourself on the roll sheet, it must be the wrong day. All right. So, all language is an approximation. The more we understand a shared understanding of the meaning of the words and the syntax, the better, right? This is why we often have misunderstandings between people that are either speak different languages initially or possibly have different education levels where the vocabulary may be more sophisticated or harder for one than for the other. What I was describing when I talked about my lover's eyes with the reflection and all of that stuff, that's a metaphor. You have to come up with something to explain it in simpler language so that it makes sense. And so we often use metaphors. Very often, the metaphor has nothing specifically to do with what you're trying to get across. But the example illustrates the point. How many of you have taken the GRE yet? When you yeah, I hope you have since you've been accepted. When you take the GRE, about a quarter of the questions are this type of question. They are metaphors. And so they're giving you words that don't mean what the combination of the words mean, and you have to decipher what it is. They'll give you a metaphor, and then they'll give you three more metaphors and say, which one is the closest? And that's the hardest, because it might be bananas are to boats, what cherries are to apples, what alligators are to, and have all these really weird, and trying to come up with the closest analogy, sometimes it's very, very difficult. But they are, that's the whole idea behind a metaphor. Now, a metonymy is a figure of speech where one word is substituted for a word closely related to it. Sometimes it is substituted for the entire whole. For example, a head of cattle, right? That's a cow, right? Or a steer or a bull, whichever it happens to be, right? But we use this metonymy to describe the one based on what we know about the larger group. The crown of the kingdom, right? We know it means the king. but we're using the crown to step in for the actual king. Lend me a hand. Can I literally lend you a hand? Or a leg? Or an elbow? No. I can help you. But that isn't what we say. We say, lend me a hand. Think about a lot of the things that you say, right? If you want to say somebody's an idiot, what's a polite way of saying it? I guess nobody knows the polite way, right? You only know how to say it, right? How about he's a knucklehead? Right? You know, if I say somebody's a knucklehead, you know what I mean, right? He's an idiot. In other words, I've just said his head is filled with the joints of his hand, which doesn't work, right? In Persian, I'll use that as an example, the same phrase would be his head is filled with a green vegetable stew. Right? We'll call somebody a mush head, right? Oatmeal brains, oatmeal for brains. That's what a mush head is, right? Those are common, right? So as you translate things, I remember when I did do my translation exam for my Ph.D., there were things that I didn't, I'd look at these words and I knew what each word meant, but I didn't know what it meant, right? I didn't know the colloquialisms. I didn't know the phrase. And so what did I have to do? Well, I had to translate it exactly, which means nothing. Right? But it showed that I at least knew what the friggin' words meant, right? So when I was going over it with my advisor, not my advisor, but the guy who did the grading, he was like, well, you missed some of the slang terms and some of the metaphors. It's like, well, duh, right? You know, I don't use it every day. So that's a metonymy. So we're talking about two guys, Sapir and Worf. They overlap in their careers. About the same age. And they argue that language shapes and molds our thinking and that we experience the world based on the language we understand. And so five of us may see the same thing. But there are a number of us from very different cultures. We have international students in here. We have people who were raised in homes very different than our own. That's just normal. We live in America, right? And depending on your first language, most of us view the world through our first language and then either translate or we know our second language well enough to be able to do it. I can't think in either of my second languages. But if you can, that helps. But this is one reason why knowing multiple languages actually makes you a richer person, because you get more points of view, because you have more ways of expressing. I have a friend, a devout religious guy, born in this country, became very religious. He only prays in Spanish because for him it's a prettier language. He feels it's more reverent, it's more respectful, it's a prettier language, right, than doing it in English. Just his choice, right? And so the nuances between languages are often lost in translation. They're often lost across generations. I have my U.S. history class right now is reading a book written in the 30s. And half the students struggle with the language because the language has changed that much just since the 1930s. For example, I think we talked about the word S-U-S-P-E-C-T, right? Did we talk about that in here when I was doing the language thing? The word suspect. Well, it can also be pronounced suspect. If you watch any old movies made before 1932, the cops are going to go out and pick up the usual suspects. Because prior to the 30s, that word was pronounced the same way for both definitions of suspect and suspect. Right? This gives you a problem with shift F7. That's why we did talk about this before. But that's how language changes over time. And so the meanings and the cultural references that are attached to those meanings can often suffer. Food, we use the French. And the animal we use, the other. But these are kind of the way that these languages migrate across time. And so it's just kind of, they go, I'm not going to go through all the details, it's just there. There are about 7,000 known living languages in the world. Languages die, and languages are sometimes brought back. A friend of mine, before he died a few years ago, was concentrating on pulling together the language of the Mono, and giving them a written form so that they could write down their stories and they would be able to pass it down in a more up-to-date form than by just grandma's telling stories. The Gaelic language, the language spoken in Wales and versions of it spoken in Scotland and Ireland, essentially were dead because the English forbade people from using it. But in the last 30 years in Scotland, in Ireland, and in Wales, all three of those countries, which are part, Republic of Ireland is a separate country, but Northern Ireland is part of Great Britain. All of those have focused on reclaiming their language. And now, I once applied to grad school in Wales. I had to fill out a form that was written both in Welsh and in English. All of their documents have both on them. All their street signs have both on them because they wanted to bring their language back, because that's often how a group is defined, right? It's through their language. Even when languages are closely related, for example, Argentinians and Mexicans, I don't know how they communicate with each other. They both speak Spanish, but they speak two completely different forms of Spanish. When I lived in Cleveland, two doors down were Puerto Ricans. I could barely understand them. When the moving truck showed up from Texas and the guys spoke real Mexican, I could finally talk to somebody and understand them when they were speaking to me. Otherwise, it was just a blur. When I was in grad school, my friend from Argentina, when she knew I had to take my language exam, she decided she was only going to speak to me in Spanish. I couldn't understand. I literally, all it was tha 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 tha. And I'm like, what the fuck are you saying? So I'd ask my friend from Mexico, what is she saying? She'd go, I don't know, I can't understand her either.
I think probably the development of writing was one of the most significant steps in human civilization, to be set on a par almost with the development of settled life and farming that really is the basis, the foundation for all subsequent change.
Like most other facets of the development of mankind, archaeologists are discovering that the roots of writing are far older than previously thought.
People were recording information much earlier than they were writing. Even back in the Ice Age, people were making strange markings on bones that weren't just someone just seeing if their flint knife was sharp enough or something. They're regular.
And microscopic study has suggested these notches haven't been just all done at once. They've recorded one and then another. And another, and it's been argued that these were to record the moon, the waxing and waning, and the appearance of the moon.
One of those at the forefront of pioneering work on the subject is Denise Schmant-Bessera, who recently made a breakthrough discovery. An archaeological excavation at Ain Ghazal in Jordan had uncovered a large amount of clay tokens. These tokens varied in shape from abstract cones and spheres to more defined shapes such as animals and tools. Were these gaming pieces? Some kind of religious iconography? Schmant-Bessera discovered the amazing truth.
She was able, by working back from the earliest writings in Sumeria, the different shapes that were used for different things, she realized that these were ways of recording things like different kinds of animals, different amounts of grain, oil, and even more abstract things like one man's work for one day or one man's work for one week. So each one stood for something different. And then she found this sort of hollow egg-shaped clay envelope, and inside there were a lot of these little different shaped clay objects.
These clay envelopes were a form of ancient accounts, probably records of trade or sacrifice.
Then they thought, well, what do we really have to open it up every time we want to check what's inside? Why don't we make the markings on the outside? So if there were two, say, pyramid shapes inside, they'd put two triangles on the outside so that you wouldn't have to go and look in every time. Then they realized, well, if we record it on the outside, we don't actually need ever to look inside. In fact, we don't even need an inside, so we'll make it flat. And that is basically how you get to the clay tablet, which is the earliest way things were written down.
These signs, used by ancient accountants, evolved into a sophisticated script and later became simplified into wedge-like marks etched with a stylus. This first written script has become known as cuneiform, from the later Latin word for wedge, cuneus. Its translation is attributed to one Henry Rawlinson, who by 1850 had spent nearly 20 years copying and deciphering its codes from an inscription on an inaccessible cliff face in what is modern-day Iraq. This Sumerian writing is the oldest that archaeologists have so far discovered, although it is now known that in other civilizations writing evolved in a very different way.
If you look in China, it's a completely different situation because the earliest writings have got nothing to do with economics at all. They're all to do with divination, basically a sophisticated form of fortune telling.
They took bones and drilled holes in them and applied hot brands, hot bits of metal, which made the bone crack. And then they would interpret the crack as meaning something about a problem they had with sickness or hunting or the weather. Then they inscribed the questions they posed to the oracle and the answers on those bones.
The Chinese script is made up of over 3,000 characters, each symbol representing a different concept, which means that the same set of characters can be used throughout China, even if the spoken language is different. Most early scripts were in this ideogrammatical form, and the language of ancient Egypt was no exception. The hieroglyphic script of Egypt is one of its most familiar hallmarks. But unlike China, all use of this script had died out thousands of years ago. It was not until the discovery of the famous Rosetta Stone by a Napoleonic soldier in 1799 that the secrets of Egyptian hieroglyphs were revealed. The Rosetta Stone contained the same passage of writing in both Greek and Egyptian. This gave the French archaeologist Jean-François Champollion the clue he needed to decipher the script and further our understanding of Egypt's illustrious history. The Mayan peoples of South America also wrote in a script consisting of glyphs, but no Mayan Rosetta Stone has ever been found. Their secrets remained a closed book. Until recently.
One of the great discoveries of recent years, often been called the last great decipherment, has been the decipherment of Maya writing, been one of the intellectual triumphs of the past 20 or 30 years. The Maya writing was glyphs, and each glyph was a little sign that had a meaning, but it also had a sound. There was one priest who'd written down some glyphs and what they would mean in terms of sounds, and it was a Russian scholar who began to take this seriously, and a number of ideas came together and realized that, first of all, these stelae probably are talking about real events, and maybe they're talking about real places, so they began to look at place names and recognize the place names, which was a very important beginning of making realistic sense of them. And then the other line of thought was maybe some of them represent sounds in the language, not just all signs, but sounds, so you have to say them aloud. And then fortunately that related to some of the languages still spoken in the Maya area. So the whole thing began to come together and sort of exploded, so there's been this amazing intellectual triumph.
Previously, experts looking at the American ancients had only the texts of invading Spanish historians to work with, but now have been able to decipher the many Mayan stelae. The terrific amount of information learned from these translations has changed our view of the Mayan history. It gives us clearer insights into the Mayan religious beliefs, their view of the world, and, most importantly, the Mayan calendar, This allows archaeologists to date hundreds of recorded Mayan historical finds with great accuracy. Such exciting developments confirm that we must always be prepared to change our view of the past.
If you can be sure of anything in archaeology, apart from the fact that new things are going to be discovered, which is kind of obvious, is that normally when they're discovered, whatever you're talking about, whether you're talking about the origins of writing or the origins of urban living, the origins of agriculture, it's almost always being pushed back further in time. So what was once thought to be quite a short history of humankind is stretching out, and a lot of the achievements of mankind are continuing to be shown to have developed much earlier than we thought.
So when we're talking about, okay, they were saying Mayan. Brits cannot say Mayan. They always say Mayan. I have no idea why, other than we're two countries separated by the same language, right? We say a lot of things differently than they do. The Chinese characters that were invented over 3,000 years ago are exactly the same as the characters that are used in China today. Because unlike an alphabet, Chinese glyphs have our whole words, right? So there's a symbol that means cat. And it means cat whether you are reading it in Mandarin or Cantonese or Japanese or Korean or English. If you can read the symbols, you don't have to translate it because the symbols are the words. All you have to, if you could learn to read Chinese characters in English, you could go back and read texts that are over 3,000 years old. They haven't changed. You know how much better it would be if we had a single script that if you spoke Spanish and I spoke English, we could just write it down and you'd go, oh, that's what you're trying to say. Right? The Chinese were smart. They did a bunch of shit better than we did and before we did. The Mayan script, there was a Russian a couple of decades ago that does get it started. But when I was an undergrad at UCLA in the 1990s, was when they were really, really, really beginning to do the translations. And they had for many years, since the late 60s, we had deciphered the calendar, which the Mayan calendar, the Olmec calendar, the Aztec calendar, they're all the same calendar. They all have the same dates, they all have the same start dates, they all have the same end dates, they all have the same number of months, they all have the same number of days in each month, they're all 20 months of 18 days each. So, do languages change? Do languages change? Yay or nay?
Yeah.
Of course they do. Why? Well, we'll talk about that. Languages often change because they need to. Because of changes in social, political, economic, artistic, a lot of different reasons why language might change. Every year we add dozens of new words to the Oxford English Dictionary. Technology often is what creates new words, right? You've got technology all over you that it was only been named in the last 5 or 6 years, right? This particular clicker, I like it because it has both an RF, meaning it's got a plug-in that I can hit to. It also hits Bluetooth. Where the fuck is Bluetooth? Why is it called Bluetooth? Well, that's a stupid name, right? Nobody's got a Bluetooth. Why is it called Bluetooth? I'm sorry, what? Good guess. It's not right, but it's a good guess, right? No, Harald Bluetooth was the greatest Danish king of all time, and it was the Danes who invented the Bluetooth technology, and so what did they do? They took the symbol for his name. That B that's on that little weird symbol that's the Bluetooth symbol, that's the Norse rune for Harald Bluetooth. See, history does matter, right? I know, it doesn't, you don't give a shit where the name comes from, but that's where it comes from, you know? Impress your friends. It can change because of colonization, right? Or invasion, right? Persians didn't have a Persian word for car. So when they become a colonial power and people are driving around in cars, they call it a car. or an auto, right? Same in Spanish. What's a bus? An autobus, right? There wasn't a word, no word existed for a bus until a bus existed. It's like your dog, right? We all call our dogs, right? Unless it's a hound, which is a specific type of dog. But until the 7th or 8th century AD or CE, the English language didn't have the word dog. Every dog was a hound. In fact, we don't know where the word dog comes from. It just one day appeared and then took over. And hound got shunted to the side. Hound is the German word, Hund, right? Dachshund, which they don't call dachshunds, dachshunds. They're called dackles, right? The German word for dachshund is dackel. English is a language is a wonderful thing. So we often have to come up with new terms because of technology. We can also have to come up with new terms because of changes in thought. Also, individuals use language very differently, right? Think of our last five presidents. They all use the language very differently, right? George Bush, kind of folksy, but still elevated a little bit. Barack Obama, Rhodes Scholar, constitutional law professor, always very haughty and kind of high, and turned a lot of people off because of it. Current guy, he's a fucking vulgarian, right? He swears as much as I do. And that popularizes it, right? It puts it out there. This is a way to speak. This is a type of phrasing. Also, every generation comes up with its own slang, right? So things like, if you want to say something is good, but what would your slang be for something that is just the best it can possibly be? Your generation slang. You got a word for that? If something's really good, what is it? Is it bitchin'? Is it boss? Is it rad? Is it? I mean, there are lots of. You guys don't have one? It's what? It's fire. Okay. It's what? It's dope. That's one I hear a lot, right? My generation, it was things were boss, or things were bad if they were really good. Man, that's bad, dude. Really, what's wrong with it? Nothing, man. It's bad, right? Because partly we do it because we don't want our parents to understand us, because we think we're smarter than they are. We all do, until we realize that about age 40, that our parents were pretty cool in the long run. Well, maybe not all of them, but some of them were. So, and that changes language. Right? Not just the technology as it changes, but the words that we use in common everyday parlance. We throw words away and acquire new words. When you're born, you are capable of making every sound in every human language. And the first year or so, all you do is you filter out the sounds that you don't need. So by the time you're about a year and you begin to start vocalizing more than just blah, 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 you've already kicked out of your brain all the sounds that you don't think you're going to need. Which means that 15 years later, when you have to go to high school and you got to take a language and you can't pronounce the words because you can't make the sounds, you're going to struggle. If you want your children to be multilingual, their first 2 years expose them to, even if it's just music, or people speaking in conversations, or whatever. Just give your children, expose them to all of, you know, as many different languages as you can, because they won't filter those sounds out. Then later, when they try to be multilingual, they'll be able to make sounds like hey, ng, things that we don't normally make in English, right? So even at a baby, your brain is filtering parts of language away that you're not going to need. So that you're prepared as you're acquiring your language, which is how you acquire your culture through acculturation, is where you get it. You guys come up with, you know, your generation comes up with something being dope. We think dope, that's somebody that's stupid, right? Or, man, it was really bad, meaning it was really good, right? And changes can occur in vocabulary, right? Different words. Pronunciation, suspect and suspect, it's a prime example. also in the structure. Now, this is the slowest to change. And written language is much slower than spoken language. So there are a lot of things like dangling participles that we can say in spoken English that aren't a problem. But you do it in written English and it's going to be wrong. That's why you don't write the way you talk. Right? I hope I got that clear to you. Now, languages can morph in other ways. One of the ways they can morph is they can become a pidgin. Now, a pidgin is a language created through social conditions, such as trade, that develops between two groups who speak two completely different languages. So the patois that is Cajun is a pidgin. Or it started out as a pidgin. It will eventually become its own dialect, but it starts out as a pidgin. So that is a pidgin, is a language that's created through social contexts such as trade that develops between two groups who speak two completely different languages. A Creole is a pidgin on steroids. It has become a full language with all of the elements of syntax and grammar and all of that stuff, a lexicon, etc. All Creole languages come out of pidgins. One of the things that has made English the current lingua franca, the current language that is used universally, is imperialism, right? Colonialism. When you have an English-speaking power that controls China, big parts of India, big parts of Africa, big parts of the Americas, pretty much is everywhere, right? And so that imposes that language on the groups that are underneath it, the original groups, which then develop pidgins, which then develop Creoles, because they're a mix of the two. A lingua franca, as I said, is any language that is considered to be the universal international language. Lingua franca used to be French. In the 19th century and into the 20th century until 1914, all of the European governments at court and all legal documents and all scientific documents were written in French, regardless of what your language was. But as America became more ascendant in the late 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, we didn't speak that much French. So we published all of our shit in English, in American business English, which is a specific dialect of American English. And that's what 90% of all scientific reports, whether you're in China or Russia or Swaziland, you publish in English, because that's the largest market. Right? And so the lingua franca, the language that used to be French, which was universal, is now English. So it might be weird that English is the lingua franca, but that's the way we're not going to change the phrase to make it lingua anglais, which would then be French again. Now, a dialect is a variety of a language used by people from a particular geographic area. It's a complete system. It may or may not be written. We have things here in this country, like Gullah, like Creole, the patois that is for Louisianans. The Cajun, right? Where are the Cajun located in this country? Anybody know? Yeah, where in the United States? Where? Yeah, Louisiana. Where'd they come from? Nope, it came from French-speaking Acadia in Canada. They split after the Revolutionary War and headed for Louisiana, which was still French-speaking, because Canada was now an English part, right? Louisiana was still owned by French, being run by Napoleon's brother, because Napoleon had put his brother, his cousin, his sister, a whole bunch of other people on different thrones across across Europe. But it was French territory, so the Acadians moved to Louisiana, where Spanish was spoken because it was currently under control by the Spanish brother, the Spanish king, who was the brother of Napoleon, treats, because that is one of the three languages that was spoken in that same area. Right? So, a dialect has its own vocabulary and grammar. It's not a Creole or pidgin, it has, or a slang or jargon. It is a language spoken by a certain class or a certain group, for example, or even as something that could be a certain geographical area. So years ago, I was at a meeting, and the guy was showing slides of something. I don't remember what it was, but sitting in front of me were two Persian women. And one of the slides was of his daughter, and I heard one of the Persian women speak to the other Persian women and say she must have gotten it from her mother because she sure didn't get her looks from her dad. But she said it in Persian, figuring nobody around her would be able to understand her. So I leaned forward and I said, you really shouldn't make fun of people in Persian when there are other Persian speakers sitting around you. So they switched to Sangasari, which is a language spoken in one single village in Sangasar in the mountains of Iran, which happened to be where they came from. So these people are, those two particular women were probably, they spoke at least four languages because they spoke English, they spoke Persian, they spoke Sangasari, and one spoke French and one spoke Spanish, right? Everywhere else around the world, people learn multiple languages. We're the only place in the world that can't seem to even get one down, right? That's why you have this W class and why I'm going to start grading you down for grammar in your posts. Please load Grammarly on your computer. Some of your posts are almost illegible, and I haven't been taking points away, but I will starting on the next batch. Now, whether something is labeled a dialect might be political. You might want to include them in the larger body, and so say it's just a dialect. Or you might say it's a separate language to separate them out. It might be politically advantageous for whatever reason to keep them part of your community or to make it as a separate community. What's the official language in the United States? There isn't one. That's exactly right. We don't have an official language. We had an election once to pick an official language. You know what won? German. Because the largest white minority in this country is not people of English stock. They are of German stock. Right? They're still Saxon, because the Saxons are Germans, right? But when we say Anglo-Saxon, everybody goes, oh, English. No, they're the third largest white minority. There are more people of Irish descent in this country than there are of English descent. And there are more people of German descent in this country than there are people of Irish descent. So language often, you know, some countries, like France, right? France, prior to the 20th century, spoke up to 80 different languages. Can you imagine living in a country about the size of California and having every community speak a slightly different language, so much so that the people in the north and people in the south can't even speak to each other? And so in the 20th century, France has been a pain in the ass about language, right? They want you to speak French and French only. They want you to speak it properly. Right? They're very, very chauvinistic about French because they're trying to unify people with a single language. Right? That was the whole purpose behind that, right? If we're all speaking the same language as our first language, then we agree with it. We understand each other because we all know the same meanings to the same words. If we're speaking 80 different languages in a space that small, you're not really unified, right? And so language. So sometimes governments will make official policies. Right? We've gone the other way. There have been movements to speak English only, and there have been movements to say we should accommodate anybody and everybody. We do provide bilingual education. Usually it is to transition into English-only education. We used to provide more bilingual than we do now. We don't have a whole lot of policies trying to salvage languages as a government. Some countries, like I said, Wales, Ireland, Northern Ireland, Scotland, France. These are countries that really said, we're going to speak a language. This is the language we're going to speak, or we're going to keep our language alive. We don't really do that. Like I said, it was an individual trying to salvage the Mono language. The government isn't out there with a project going, you know what, we need to preserve all of the native tribal languages and find a way to write them down. We don't do that. Now we look at language through its grammar and structure. We also look at it through the speech, the language practices. Sociolinguistics is a study of the effect of any and all aspects of society, including cultural norms, expectations, and context, on the way language is used. In other words, it studies how we use language. Right? And even in your own life, you use language multiple ways. We call it code switching, right? Talking to your bros, hey, motherfucker, did you see that bitch? She was hot, right? You talk to mom and go, mother, I met a young lady today. She was very lovely. Right? Now, we all live in multiple speech communities. Many of you live in homes that are bi or trilingual. That's multiple speech communities in your own home. But even those of us that all speak English, we live in different speech communities. Your family, your home, when you go see mom and dad, you're living in a different speech community than when you're hanging out at the dorm or sitting at the bar across the street. Right? Language changes. We use language different ways. Another reason why you can't say, I write the way I talk, because you don't talk the same way all the time. You change the way you speak, depending on who you're speaking to. Right? Like I've said before, I sure the fuck don't write the way I talk. Right? No, nobody's going to publish every other word as fuck. It's just not going to happen, right? But it keeps you awake. So I do it. Eventually, I stop doing it because it doesn't have any effect after a while. But it's still keeping you awake because every time I do it, you go, oh, you said it again. Slang, jargon, this is a very common thing for speech communities to come up with because it defines something within it, right? Think of the various communities you may be part of. You may be part of a study group. You may be part of your major. You have a lot of friends that are in your same major or a related major. You may be in a D&D group. You may be in a community online. And in each of those places, there is different jargon, different language you use to describe different things. And that same language may have other meanings, different jargon in different groups, depending on where you're at. So, we often talk about a speech community as being someone that is a real community living in the same location, say a neighborhood, or a family, or an office. But what about online, right? That changes a lot of things, right? If you're only typing, is it still a speech community? I would say, think so, right? If you're talking to somebody and they're using an auto translator at the other end to get your meaning, different speech community? Are you, right? I mean, a lot of the stuff we have to reevaluate when it comes to online. In order for us to truly communicate properly, both the sender and the receiver must understand every word we say in the context that we say it and in the structure that we say it. This is often what causes a lot of misunderstandings. And as I said, we're all members of multiple speech communities. We often do, as I said before, a lot of code switching. We do that sometimes using the same language, but using different versions of it, depending on where we are or who we're with. It can also be when you're switching from English to Spanglish to Spanish. I only speak Spanglish. My Spanish isn't good enough to be called real Spanish. And you'll see this a lot. If someone is proficient in English and proficient in Spanish, and they're having a conversation with someone whose English is proficient and their Spanish is proficient, they will often use the word that best fits what they're trying to say, regardless of which language they're speaking. Right? That's why we end up with Spanglish. Well, one of the reasons we end up with Spanglish. You get bad Spanish speakers like me, that's how you end up with Spanglish, right? All right, any questions on language?